All right. I think we're live, which is a win. All right. So thank you all for joining us today. My name is Jocelyn, and we're here today on this fabulous Wednesday hosting an MMSD Coping During COVID-19 series, which has just been a way for MMSD to continue to connect with the community, give another platform that we might not otherwise be able to have, and in this case, try to keep it formal and interactive. And in that case, I'm going to swing it over to my other co-host of sorts.
Hi, everyone. My name is Cherie Haas. My pronouns are she and her. I'm the LGBTQIA+ lead for the Madison School District. It's wonderful to be here today. And I am thrilled to be able to introduce three student leaders from Memorial High School's Gender Equity Association. They are, they've been doing tons of community organizing efforts during the COVID-19 pandemic. And I think you're gonna find this is how they've coped. This is how they are inspiring others and inspiring themselves during a pretty difficult time. So thanks for tuning in.
Sounds good.
Right.
Thank you, Cherie. Yeah, so I believe, look it, there's one.
There they go.
There's two. Cherie, get out of here.
I'm away. Trying.
There we go. Wait. Still missed. There we go. The star, the real stars of our show. So again, as Cherie said, we have three young people here from Memorial High School, and we are going to give them an opportunity to, hold on, introduce themselves. And it looks like, unlike some of the other Facebook Lives I've done, we actually have like slides. This is fancy, right? Is that true, young people?
Yeah,
they're all nodding. They're like, okay, old person in your 40s, yes, we do slides. So each person is going to have an opportunity to share name, pronouns, grade, and whatever else is in the slide. So I'm not sure who's going first, but take it away.
Hi, everyone. My name is Maggie. I use she, her, hers pronouns. I am in 11th grade. I'm a junior at Memorial High School. And one thing that I've been doing over quarantine is reading a lot. I've reread the Harry Potter series. So yeah, I'm kind of a book nerd.
Yeah. I'm Melanie Golden. My pronouns are she, her, hers. I'm a junior at Memorial, I guess rising senior, very nerve-wracking. I'm the co-president of the Gender Equity Association, and one of the activities that I've been up to during quarantine has been baking. I'm now obsessed with chocolate scones and monkey bread and all that good stuff, so.
Oh, no. There you go. You got it.
Oh, there we go.
There we go.
Hi. My name is Amira Pierotti. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and they, them, theirs. And I am a sophomore to be a rising junior. And I am the vice president of the Gender Equity Association. And I've really enjoyed playing with my cats during quarantine.
Of course, I love it. Cats are wonderful. One of the cool things about hosting this for me is I had not met these young people until this. So one of the cool things is I actually don't know a lot of the answers to the questions that I'm going to ask. So I get to learn right along with so many of you. In looking at here, it looks like Melanie, you have the opportunity right now to tell us a little bit about the Gender Equity Association at Memorial. You'll give us some background, what it is. And then after that, you all have a chance to share some of your proud moments too. So Melanie, take us away, hon.
Yeah, so the Gender Equity Association was formed by the three of us. Last year, Maggie and I were both vice presidents of our school's women's club, as well as the sexual assault prevention club. And so we decided to merge them to get like a lot more opportunity to kind of like make our impact. Oh.
Frozen.
Anyway, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, but you're frozen.
Oh, no. Yeah. Are we all right? Oh, no.
Oh.
All right.
We can hear you.
Uh-oh. Can I talk for Mel for a quick
wait.
Second? Yeah.
Take it away, Maggie.
Yeah, so basically the Gender Equity Association, like Melanie was saying, we merged the Women's Club and the Sexual Assault Prevention Club into the Gender Equity Association. And since just starting this year in 2019, the fall, we've been dedicated, our mission statement is kind of to advance the rights of women, trans, gender expansive, non-binary individuals. We try and promote diverse and intersectional feminism, and that sexism is directly linked to other forms of oppression, and we try to kind of cover that in our group. In the past year, we've worked on a campaign to increase awareness for gender confidentiality. We've fundraised to get menstrual products in shelters. We've helped rewrite MMSD health curriculum and the behavior education plan. Oh, and Mel's back. Yay.
Sorry, I'm back. My internet was a little bit flaky. So.
No, you're okay. Do you want to keep talking about what we were doing this year, Mel?
You're all good if you want to just keep going.
Sure, okay.
Not sure.
We talked about consent-based and LGBTQ plus inclusive curriculum in MMSD. We've talked about media representation for females, femmes, and LGBTQ folk. We've lobbied for gender inclusivity at the Capitol, and we've done just a ton of projects that we are super excited to kind of cover and continue next year.
Very nice. So not at all not busy. I think that was a double negative, but it sounds like you all have been super busy. So one of my favorite parts I'm excited to hear is a proud moment that each one of you gets to share about all of the work you've been doing.
Yeah, so I kind of, as Maggie said, that I missed out on, we've been trying to do as much as we can to create like a lasting impact. But one of my favorite things that we've done is we're currently sponsoring a girls' education in Kenya. So we had a bake sale, and we kind of like raised like support, and also like we raised awareness for a lot of young women lack access to education. So that was really exciting for me.
Cool.
Yeah. One of my proudest moments was raising money around the schools to get free menstrual products, so pads and tampons, out to different students in the Dane County community. We went around to different history classes, presented a bit about period poverty and menstrual equity, gave out flyers and that kind of stuff, educated people on the issue, and then raised a lot of money, and we were able to serve 400 periods, or the menstrual product equivalent. So yeah, that was really awesome.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
Amira? One of my proudest moments was when we visited multiple elementary schools this year to read books about trans inclusivity. So I went back to my old elementary school, Crestwood, and in one of the second grade classes, we were reading and discussing, and at some point I mentioned, oh, I'm transgender, here's where I fit on the gender spectrum. And we had a great discussion about gender inclusivity in the classroom. And at the end, we were handing out stickers, and one girl came up to me, gave me a hug, and said, I'm trans too. And I was just super sweet.
That is sweet. That's amazing. So what's cool now is we're going to move into some of the projects that the youth, the three of these young people have been working on, and you might hear some overlap in terms of what they're proud of, but you're also going to hear some new things. So each one is going to have the opportunity to tell us the major projects that they've been working on among all of the schoolwork, among all the other things that each one of them is doing that they've maintained during quarantine.
Yeah, so just a little bit of background. When quarantine started and we were out of school, we still wanted to maintain all of the valuable discussions that we were having in GEA and pick up some of the projects that were kind of left unfinished because we can no longer meet as a group and work in person. So Amira, Mel, and I sat down and we're like, okay, how are we going to navigate this online space so that we make sure that everyone is safe and healthy and included, but also they feel like they still have the outlet that the Gender Equity Association can be. So we decided to separate the clubs into three different committees based on their interests after a survey. And the three different committees that we kind of started were the Menstrual Equity Committee, which is what I led, the Domestic Abuse Resources Committee, which is what Melanie led, and the LGBTQ plus inclusive during quarantine, which is what Amira led. So the committee that I worked on, if you go to the next slide, was menstrual equity. So this was, again, like a continuation of all of the work that we had been doing for menstrual equity in MMSD, but just in the virtual sphere. So we held different meetings and interactive things for the community to join, be it a Kahoot game, game shows, different presentations, covering issues all surrounding menstruation, be it eco-friendly period products, gender neutrality in the menstrual movement, the tampon tax in Wisconsin, and basically just wanted all kinds of people and all youth, especially from MMSD high schools and middle schools, to come and get involved in the conversation so that they can start thinking about these issues even when they're at their home. And it has just been a wonderful experience for us.
Yeah. So kind of moving on to my committee, I was leading the Domestic Abuse Resource Kit Committee. Kind of like Maggie said, we were working, there's tons of like different resources out there, and we wanted to compile that to make sure that kind of everyone had easy access and they could find the hotline or like resource that best fit for them. So since there's more increased amount of people that are like inside of their homes and don't have that outlet system that a lot that they can access through being able to leave their homes, we decided to compile this. So on the screen are a couple of the like slides that we created that are related to different hotlines and things that everyone should be able to access. We've been sharing it through a couple of social media platforms. If you check out our Facebook or our Instagram, you can find it there. And also we've been encouraging people to share them as well. So yeah.
Yeah. So my committee has been working on a social media campaign to support LGBTQIA plus youth during quarantine. Many youth are stuck at home with unsupportive families, and they are isolated from their support systems, such as their GSAs, and are having trouble connecting with other LGBTQ plus youth online. So our campaign called LGBTQ plus Kids Quarantined has been compiling resources such as mental health resources, ways to connect with LGBTQ plus youth online, tips to learn about the broader LGBTQ plus community, tips on coming out to your family, and more to kind of create this community online. So we try to post 3 to 5 times a week with a variety of topics. One of our favorite things to do is to have panels, which you can see in the top of our screen, where we invite diverse folk to talk about their experiences with being LGBTQ plus relating to a certain topic. We've had panels on LGBTQ plus and religion. We've held ones on sexuality and gender and coming out to your family. Recently, we've heard back from some youth saying that this has been supportive, and that's only motivated us to do more and to continue to be present throughout the duration of quarantine. We are also incredibly excited to announce that we received a grant from the Tegan and Sarah Foundation. We are among 22 other groups from across the United States who are honored to be part of these recipients, and we are hoping to use these funds to host more panels and to be able to bring more resources to our campaign.
This is my favorite part. There we go. Just wait. It's like getting the right puzzle pieces back together. So awesome. Thank you all for sharing on that one. And here's a good question too. This one's good because I think adults do a lot of times they'll guess at what we think youth need. Just this thing that we do as adults. So we want to ask you all as youth, what are you hearing from your peers in your community? What's challenging, what's needed, what's going well? There can be some things that are going well right now. And it looks like Amira, you get to tackle this one.
Yeah. So what we heard from a lot of our peers is that it's really hard to stay motivated during this time. For many youth, we feel very isolated and helpless to make a change during a really tough situation. Many students have lost their support systems, and that has led to them really struggling with being able to say, I'm going to sit down and I'm going to get my work done. However, our peers have been very resilient and have found the positives in this situation as well. A lot of youth are taking advantage of the flexible schedules to be able to take care of their own responsibilities, their schoolwork, as well as taking time for their mental health. Quarantine has also provided youth time to get around to activities that they may not usually get to, such as hanging out with their families or reading a book.
I muted myself because my 8-year-old now is deciding that it's a good time to hang out in the living room with me. So I was like making sure I was muted. So thank you, Amira. That was super, super helpful to understand in a short time what it's like for youth right now. So coming back around, so as youth are working through the quarantine and trying to figure out how to navigate all of this, in addition to navigating, I think when we met last time, it was prior to some of the stuff that's been going on across the country following George Floyd's death. And we want to talk about now, why is it important for youth to be engaged in our local communities, especially at this time?
Yeah, so it's always important for youth to have a voice in politics and in policy change and in community service, because youth can provide an inclusive and progressive view of life that often gets overlooked. But right now, especially, youth grassroots activism is incredibly important, not only for the community, because it provides that new perspective that can be totally valuable for the majority of its citizens, but it also can be used as a means of wellness for youth themselves. So just like Amira said, many youth and students in particular are feeling unmotivated, powerless with all of the things that have been going on in the news, quarantine, being stuck at home, not feeling like they are able to get their schoolwork done. But in reality, even doing small acts of community service, raising awareness and sparking dialogues about some of these issues that are incredibly challenging to tackle can be very valuable for youth to kind of feel as though they have a say in what's going on in their community and they have the power to tackle it. We shouldn't have to wait until we become adults to have a say in politics and have a say in the different things that are going on in our community, especially if they're impacting us. And we are seeing so many youth across the country right now, especially with the Black Lives Matter movement, take a stand for their own safety, their own community. And it is incredible how much awareness and change we are seeing happen. So youth can do it by volunteering at food pantries, making toolkits about issues they care about, lobbying for different legislation, and even just having political conversations with their friends.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Friends, family, anyone they can get their hands on. I just want you two to, or you two, there are four of us, there's three of you. Some of the comments, I don't know if you all are noticing them, but some of the people watching, just really impressed with the work that you're doing. One of the quotes is actually says, you're blowing my mind right now. And I think it's important for the world to know that, like, teenagers, in a lot of ways, this is what y'all do, right? This is what y'all do. So keep it up. And now, if you could share with our audience, like, yes, all of those things that you said, Maggie, can each one of you now share, like, how can they learn more about the activism in our community, any of the projects going on? And again, in light of all the stuff with Black Lives Matter and all of the marches and everything, how can they find out more and how can they get involved?
Yeah, so I think, like, one of the things that I find is a useful tool is social media. Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, all social media platforms right now are talking about the Black Lives Matter movement, which is incredibly pertinent to what's going on right now. but also about so many different campaigns that are happening all across the country and even in Madison and Dane County, our community. So many youth are taking advantage of social media, and I think that it's a really powerful tool that can be used for good in a lot of ways.
Yeah. That's one of the other two now. Share your wonderful knowledge.
Yeah. Kind of like what Maggie said, one of the things that like we focus on a lot, especially like in like kind of an era where youth can share their voice as much as they can, and we focus a lot on like kind of connecting ourselves with other like similar communities that we can relate to, such as like we have had a couple of meetings with like the East High School GEA and like, you know, our school's GSA, like, and even outside of that, other larger nonprofits are always like good resources for us as well. We always like to feature a couple of guest speakers throughout the year so that the people in our club don't have to listen to the three of us talk every day and they can hear some quite similar, but also like refreshing points of view. So yeah, we work with like the domestic abuse intervention services, the Rape Crisis Center and Planned Parenthood. And we just like to, you know, try to stay as connected in our community as we can. So.
Yeah, I would like to add that it's also important to continue to uplift youth voices even after the pandemic ends. I think that we all think, and we've seen youth demonstrate that youth voices are able to change the world, and it's incredible. And even though we're considered too young or not experts on a topic, you hear youth pushing local politics, you hear youth making change in public opinion because of what they write in their newspapers. And it's incredible. And we need to make sure that we're taking time to listen to these, not just now, but continuing. Also, the same is true for the Black Lives Matter movement. Mm-hmm. There is so much attention right now on the murders of Nina Pop, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, Tony McDade, and so many more. And it's important that this wave of support for the Black community and this wave of people saying we need a change and we need it now doesn't end in a day or in a week or in a month, because this needs to continue. And as folks who want to support the Black community and who work to earn the title of being an ally, we need to continue, not just while it's trending, not just while we're seeing it and on news stories or on our social media, but continuing to uplift voices even after the rest of the world has shifted its focus away.
Agreed. How comfortable are you if I throw a bonus question at y'all?
Go for it.
Because I know the last question and it's a good one, but I hit the wrong button. As I'm sitting here, I'm wondering if each one of you could speak just shortly to why did you get into grassroots organizing? Why?
Yeah. For me, I've definitely grown up with a little bit, a lot too much sometimes compassion, and like the way that like every negative experience that I hear about hits me very hard. And that's kind of led to me becoming like part of grassroots organizations as like a person who is half Asian and half white and a woman. There's like quite a lot of like communities that I feel are very underrepresented and need a lot more attention in order to kind of be as uplifted as they need to be. And so that's kind of where I got my start. And like, you know, I would definitely say that sixth grade me and my friends, you know, having little debates about different political like movements and different like opinions that we could have definitely played a part. But in general, just like I grew up in the sense that like I knew that this was something that interested me and I wanted to do whatever I could to be a part of social justice. So.
Sounds good. Before the two of you answer, I want to make sure, audience, if you're out there, I know you're out there because I see you looking. You want to toss in some questions here as we start to wrap up? Go ahead. I am certain that the three humans sitting with me are able to answer virtually any question way better than I can. So thank you very much for answering why you got into Grassroots. So one of the other two, share with us, why'd you get involved?
Yeah, so similar to Melanie, I have just always been very interested in politics. Not even activism when I was in middle and elementary school, but more so just like politics and political theory and how our government works. And then once I started to develop my own opinions about things, I was like, whoa, we have to do something. I feel like things are moving too slowly or no one's speaking out against that. And I really just wanted to do something. I wanted to change things, not just at the national level, but at the local level. Mm-hmm. I saw inequities occurring in my own school and in my own community, and I wanted to do something about it. So once I was kind of once I was a fresh person and got into high school, I was introduced to all of the wonderful other high schoolers and upper class people who had been working diligently at making the Memorial community and generally the Dane County community and Wisconsin community a more inclusive and thoughtful place. And I was like, I need in on this. And ever since I've just been going with it. So yeah.
Perfect. Awesome. Thank you. Amira, tell us why.
Yeah, for me, I didn't really know that activism would become such a passion until last year. Similar to Maggie, I was interested in politics, and I was very passionate about equal rights for myriad topics in middle school, but I didn't realize that how much I could make a change and how motivating it was to be engaged in activism. Then last year I was a fresh person and I was like, oh, the Teal Ribbon Club sounds cool. Oh, the Women's Club sounds cool. And then I met Mel and I met Maggie and this activist community. I was like, oh my goodness, this is incredible. And then it just kind of led me here.
Perfect. I do have a question here that was asked by an audience member. And I'm wondering if one of you would like to speak to the first part, which says, could you tell us how one of your teachers, or maybe more than one, has helped build your activism or leadership skills?
Yeah. Sophomore year, I have probably one of the best teachers I will ever have for English, Miss Mitchell. Mm-hmm. She is the leader of our social justice book club, which the three of us are also involved with, kind of, you know, the ways that we're interconnected in the activist world. But the way that she approaches a lot of different topics and a lot of current events, in the sense that she educates us and goes outside of the curriculum to inform, like, to prepare us for the real world. And while the curriculum is always important, and I respect that, it's mm-hmm. always refreshing to hear about things that aren't necessarily my MelCon paragraph, but are instead about other topics. And she related them beautifully to the curriculum as well. So she was definitely a big inspiration and a good helping hand.
Way to bring MelCon into this too. That's good. It wouldn't be a full conversation from Memorial if we didn't say MelCon. either one of Amira, Maggie, did you have a teacher that was particular in helping you build these activism or leadership?
Yeah, for me, I think I've had a bunch of teachers who were super supportive of what the different things that the Gender Equity Association, myself, and other student activists have been doing. A part of that is like, I walk in with a poster that's like, hey, I'm having a rally on Saturday. Can I hang this in your room? And then agreeing to do it. And sometimes it's incorporating your interests into discussions. That often happens in like social studies and history classes or English classes, like Melanie was saying. Mm-hmm. A lot of it is us going to them with an idea and them being full on board and ready to make it tangible. And instead of correcting things or offering like expertise, it's okay, how can I best help you? Or mm-hmm. how can I best support you and your efforts in your activism? So those kind of encounters have always been the best for me.
Great. And not to put you on the spot, but Melanie did a shout out. Do you have a shout out you want to make?
Yeah, Manhattan, the AP US and AP World history teacher. Yeah,
there you go. There you go. Shout out. All right, Amira, what about you?
Yeah, for me this year for my AP World class, I had Ms. Jansen, and she is so fantastic. And she teaches the AP World class with a social justice approach, but with the fact that she's not teaching it as a social justice approach, she's just teaching it as it is, and just without all of the ingrained racism and sexism and transphobia and all the other isms that usually become incorporated into history. And it was refreshing and eye-opening to be able to look at the world and say, this is how things actually are. Mm-hmm. And to say, okay, right here, we see the emergence of patriarchy, and then we're going to follow this to see how it impacts everything else. And it made me realize that this is how we need to frame our education system. So when we're working on the health education curriculum or on the behavior education plan, I now have a frame of reference for what tangible goal we want. And just the entire Memorial History Department is so fantastic. They're all so supportive of all social justice clubs, and like we'll be doing presentations in their classes, and we'll be like, oh, what times work best for you? And teachers will write back, oh, you know, whenever, just come in, we'll pause everything. We're so happy that you're coming in. And we're like, wow, thank you. And they just make the school a better place. So thank you to all the history teachers, and thank you to Ms. Jansen.
Awesome. Just in case you didn't know, I also was a history teacher too. So, you know, special.
Yeah.
I love history. I wish that we could get beyond that, like history repeating itself kind of stuff. But hey, we're stuck where we are, right?
Yeah.
All right. So all brilliant three of you, we are going to move into the last question, which is one I really want to hear from you, which is all of you. What is one hope for change? That's a tough one. What is one hope for change you'd like to see when we return to school next year?
Yeah, other than actually going back to school in the physical realm, right. Hopefully. One of the more like tangible policy goals that Mel, Amira, and I and the entire Gender Equity Association has been working on is making sure that all MMSD schools provide menstrual products in all bathrooms, including men's, gender neutral, and women's restrooms. This is to be trans inclusive, make sure that people have access to the products that they need to succeed educationally and be focused on their schoolwork. And I think that that is something that while we have been pushing for that in Memorial, we need regularity in terms of when, how they are dispersed. And we need to ensure that that is happening in all schools across the district.
Agreed. I sure could have used that myself when I was in middle school or high school, for sure, yeah. Without that embarrassment. So I feel you. Thank you for that work. Mm-hmm. Amira has disappeared, but I am certain that Amira will be back. So.
Mel, do you want to go?
Is Amira talking? That's why I didn't, before I said anything, I was like,
No, I'm not happy.
Okay. All right, go ahead then.
Do you mind? Okay, so one change that I'm looking forward to next year that I'm hoping for is a more inclusive health curriculum. Over the past like 2 years, we've been working really nicely with Bryn Martina and also like Ashley Riley, and kind of speaking with them about our views on the health curriculum. They've been super welcoming and like listening to our opinions quite frequently. We've had a couple of meetings. The club gets to talk. We get to share all of our experiences, and the way that we see it is it could be a lot more inclusive to LGBTQ plus students and also others. And so we're looking forward to that becoming a reality. So, yeah.
Perfect.
For me, one goal is to see MMSD renovate all the restrooms to have gender neutral bathrooms. So before quarantine hit, there was a plan in place and funds set aside to renovate all the Memorial bathrooms to be gender neutral. This was supposed to be like the first step to making all restrooms gender neutral. With quarantine, the funds have since disappeared, and it's a problem. And while all of the trans, non-binary, and gender expansive students are so grateful to MMSD to looking into this, I do think that there needs to be more of a push to creating a safer space. For trans, non-binary, and gender expansive youth, restrooms are a place of a lot of tension and a lot of unsafety. For a student who is a FTM or MTF trans person who may not be seen as passing, it can be dangerous to go into the opposite gender restroom with verbal harassment. Someone may call school authorities, and sorry, Jocelyn, I'm going to be taking your job here, but someone commented like how, in what ways you see racial justice in the fight for LGBTQ plus rights overlap. I think this is one area where a white student who is going to the right restroom, though they may be perceived as an intruder, will be less likely to be called on by authorities, have a student report on them and say, there is a man in the woman's restroom or whatever. Whereas a trans student of color is more likely to be called on this. And it's a huge problem. And I think this is something that white LGBTQ plus folk, white passing LGBTQ plus folk, and allies of the LGBTQ plus community need to be aware of. There are way too many students who are beaten up when they just need to use the restroom. And for the schools that have the gender neutral stalls, usually they're only one or two. And this is for the entire LGBTQ plus population who doesn't feel safe because they may not be visibly passing. They may be perceived as being gender expansive, even if their gender identity or gender expression even if their gender identity is of the same restroom, just their gender expression is different. And we really need to take a look into the fact that so many students are abusing the restroom privileges because it's a single stall where students can just go and play games. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge problem because for many folk who need to use this restroom, like myself, it means that you're taking 20, sometimes 30 minutes out of your day just to stand waiting to be able to use the restroom. And while there's so many things to address in the school district, I do think that we need to push this a little higher on the list to be able to sit down and say, okay, how are we going to make sure that our students can safely use the restroom and do so in a way that doesn't take out of their education time?
Agreed. Amira, thank you for that. And I know for some people watching, like, you know, the bathroom issue may seem like a small one, but, you know, just real quickly for myself, who's gender nonconforming, and yes, I have been removed from bathrooms. I've been told I'm in the wrong bathroom. I have held my bathroom stuff going through entire states in the United States just so that I wouldn't have to get out and go to the bathroom. So it might seem small, but it's a huge issue. So thank you for that. Do either Maggie or Melanie, do you want to speak to that question, which is a really powerful question about the overlap or intersection of racial justice and the fight for LGBTQ plus rights?
Yeah, that is such a crucial question to be asking, especially with a lot of the work that we do. Just to kind of clarify, racial justice overlaps with all other types of social justice. And I think it's really important to understand that we will never, ever be able to reach gender equality without reaching racial equity. And understanding that all of these issues intersect with one another, and that often historically in all of these movements, white folks and white passing folks, and particularly non-Black folks, have been suppressed and their voices haven't been recognized. And even now, as we are in June, Pride Month, recognizing, knowing our history, understanding that the first Pride was led by trans women of color, and particularly Black trans women. So understanding that all of our history has led us to the point where we still have white supremacist values, even within these social justice institutions. And it is up to us to constantly check that, to understand that, to work against that, and to uplift voices of color.
Maggie and Amira couldn't have said it better than myself. That was great. And everything they said just goes perfectly what I was thinking. So,
yeah, there's as a history teacher, there's no way I could have said it any better myself. So here's where I get to thank all of you. Truly blessed. I'm so glad to have spent the afternoon with you all. Thank you for your bravery and vulnerability and courage in doing this. It's not easy to put yourself out there. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having us. This is great.
Yeah. Absolutely. So I think we're going to do that awkward thing where you all disappear like puzzle pieces, and then Cherie comes back on. Look at, there they go. Oh, this is so fun.
I love it.
That was good.
Well, did they blow you away or what, Jocelyn?
What?
Oh, did they blow you away or what? Exactly.
I should just quit. One of them can have my job. That's all. It's just fine. Yeah. It'll be great.
I don't know. I want to start out by just thanking our awesome young leaders for being vulnerable, being out there, speaking up, saying things that are hard. I mean, I don't think folks realize how much that our youth are doing to change our schools and to push us to be better and to push us to do more and do what's right and spend our energy in the way that we need to be doing. So thank you, youth leaders. Keep it up. Keep pushing us to be the best we can be in Madison and beyond. And I can't wait to see what you accomplish in your lives.
They are the hope right now that we need, for sure. I also want to thank MMSD for allowing this platform as well. I feel privileged and thankful that we're even here having these conversations. It's a tough time. So thank you to all
friends out there, educators. Just remember, we can start working with young people at a very young age to be activists. We have students forming equity clubs and ally clubs and gender and sexuality alliances at elementary school. And if we keep pushing them and motivating them to use their talents and brilliance, I mean, it's amazing what we're going to see. And you can see they're pushing for equity and they're pushing for progressive values, and they continue to amaze me.
Yep. I always said, as a teacher, whenever I would introduce a lesson, then I would ask for input. They always had better ideas than I did, and the lessons always got better. So I would start with it and they would run with it. And it was always way better with their input. So thank you, Cherie, also for joining today on this, and then behind the scenes for all the help, too.
Lovely to be here. Everyone have a beautiful day.
See you later. Thank you all.